Hello, everybody. So my name is Hawkeye Tenderwolf, also known as DeRaps. Going through a bit of a name change situation, so you'll see both of those out there for the time being. I'm a senior architect at Kalamuna, and if for whatever reason this recording doesn't work out, if you are looking for details that you might have missed during the presentation, it's been recorded once before, and so the link is there on the front of the slides, which I'm pretty sure I linked to in the issue in the session description. Kalamuna is a full-service Drupal agency, and we are hiring. So if you are looking or know someone who is looking for a front-end or back-end position, I think we have two back-end positions in the front-end, maybe even like some sort of marketing position open. Visit our website and or go to jobs.kalamuna.com. And we are a fully distributed agency based in Oakland, California. So it doesn't matter where you are. I personally live in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And today we are going to talk about Drupal projects. Just show of hands, who has used Drupal project before? All right, okay. Who has at least heard of Drupal project before? Okay, heard of it, all right. Very good, so we'll start off giving a rundown of what it is. That's kind of a oddly named thing because talking about the Drupal project or Drupal project. So we'll go into some of the details of the composer.json file and some of the tips and tricks for configuring that to kind of maximize some of the ways that I've modified it from the original Drupal project to suit my needs. And we'll talk about other ways you can customize your start state. So other, whether through custom modules or through configuration of your settings files, other ways that you can create a really nice repeatable start state for your projects. All right, so first of all, what is Drupal project? This is going to be kind of interactive. So any ideas, just throw some words out there. What is Drupal project?
Composer template?
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. It's a template. It's a composer template. So we'll look at the code in just a minute, but it allows you to pull in the Drupal core source code and everything that goes along with it using the sort of industry best practices as best we have right now. It's always a moving target, and there are always different ways of doing things, but right now it seems to be the most agreed upon best practice way for starting off new projects or just spinning up sites for testing or playing around or anything you need to do. For a lot of different reasons, you might need to spin up a new site. All right, so there are different ways to get started with the Drupal project. Who can tell me the difference between cloning the repository, cloning the code, and using the composer command, composer create project? I'm gonna have a guess. Yeah, it turns out there's not a whole lot to it. I was kind of confused by this whole idea for a minute. But then it turns out all composer create project does is basically clones the repo and then deletes the .git directory, so it's no longer a git repo. You don't have all the history, which is really nice for things like this, because I don't know if anyone, who here has used Pantheon? Yeah, okay, like spinning up new Drupal 7 sites, you remember how long it takes to clone a repository from Pantheon? Because they include the entire git history of the entire Drupal project from like 4x or 5x, whatever. Yeah, so the repo is just huge, right? So by using composer create project, it just sort of, you know, gives you a nice, fresh, clean starting point without all the git history of the entire Drupal project, which in the case of Drupal project really isn't that large. So, you know, it was created just maybe 2 years ago or something. But it's still nice to just have a nice clean starting point. You don't really need that history because you're not pulling in upstream changes. This isn't something typically where you're pulling in changes to the composer files and things like that. So what? How else can you get started with Drupal? This is just one way to do it. Of course, there is, you know, just kind of cowboy style. You can spin up a, you know, Ubuntu on your old, you know, desktop computer under your desk or in your basement, and you know, put Apache on there, download Drupal core, and you know, boom, there you go. You're running the source code on your little home server. So it's obviously not the recommended way to do that anymore. We want to put things in source code, or we want to put things in version control, and we don't want to commit source code that is not ours to our repository, because then it clutters up our repositories. So if I'm working on a project for a client, I don't want someone else's source code or library in my repository sitting in there, because then my source code gets polluted with all this other stuff that isn't mine. So if there's some sort of, if I'm browsing back through the history trying to hunt through bugs by looking at Git history, there's a whole lot of stuff in there that wasn't written by my team. So keeping that stuff out of the repository is important. So let's take a quick look at the official documentation. So the Drupal.org documentation officially lists three different ways of getting started using Composer. So option C here, I haven't played with option B very much, but I'm pretty sure it's very similar to option C from what I've just looked at 5 minutes ago. But these options include committing all of Drupal core to your repository. So you're using Composer to get started, but then you end up actually committing the rest of the code to your repository. So that's why I don't recommend using that. And this, you know, is option A for a reason. So if you have access to Composer in your, you know, in your build process and in your environments, then this is definitely the better route. Okay. Okay, so let's go through some of the composer.json basics. So some of the things, the ways that you can tweak your Composer instance. First of all, what is Composer? Let's start there. Anyone have an idea they can throw out there? Package manager, yeah. It's a package manager for PHP, so it's a way to manage dependencies. You know, Node has npm, Node Package Manager. Ruby has what, Bundler, I think, whatever. Yeah. So you know, each language, each community has their own tool, and Composer has become the de facto one for the PHP community. As far as I know, I'm not really involved in any other PHP communities besides Drupal. But yeah. So we'll look at, in the composer.json file, which is the sort of main configuration file for your project, we'll look at how to add Drupal modules and other projects to it. We'll look at the versioning system and the sort of quirk or change to semantic versioning that we use with Drupal. We'll talk about the minimum stability flag and how that affects your ability to pull in modules. Talk about how to pull in libraries. Again, we don't want to be committing libraries and any external code to our repository. So if you need to pull in things like Colorbox or whatever library it is that you need, a lot of times back in the day, before we even used, you know, Drush Make or anything like that, you would just go download the library, put it in your repository, commit it, push it up, and there you go. Now we can do things in a much more clean fashion. We'll look at the Composer scripts area and what that could be used for. And we'll look at the extra parameter of the composer.json file and look at what we put in there. So let's go ahead and jump over to the code. So is anything cut off on there? Can you see the screen from fully left to right? Looks like I might be a little cut off here.
Is that good? That's good.
All right. Okay, so this is, you can see it's a fork of the Drupal Composer / Drupal Project repo. So this is a fork that I maintain along with my colleague Rob Loach, and it's we keep it in the Kalamuna organization. And but I use it for any kind of project that I'm working on. It's open source, so anyone can come look at this, play with it, fork it, submit pull requests to it, file issues. So there's a lot in here. We won't go through everything. It's kind of over time accumulated more and more sort of little sweet modifications and customizations to just ease our workflow that we use on most of our projects. But so to get started, we'll look at the composer.json file. Oh no.
Should it open?
Well, I can pull this up locally if we need to. Looks like. Come on, bye. I think I might have just accidentally turned it off when I was trying to. Yeah, there we go. There we go. All right. Lovely. So this is the composer.json template that we start with on all of our projects. So step one is, would be, of course, on any new project, changing this to be the GitHub project or whatever. Version control system we're hosting on, putting that name in there, did the description, and going down, this right here is very important. Does anyone know what this line does right here?
As Drupal is the repository?
Yes, so this is what allows us to pull in Drupal modules and other projects from Drupal.org. So that happened maybe about a year or so ago, maybe more than that, where Drupal began hosting officially began hosting packages on Drupal.org. This has been available longer, before then, but it was not hosted officially by Drupal. It was hosted by the Drupal Composer project on another domain. So this basically takes packages.org, which is the official source for all the composer packages, which we don't publish every single one of our Drupal projects on packages.org. We maintain our own list, and this is how we get access to it. We'll skip the other repository there and start looking at the require statement. So this is where we get started adding in the projects that we want on, or the modules and libraries that we want on every single one of our projects. So let's take a quick look at the original upstream Drupal project. You can see their repository is a lot less in it because it needs to be bare bones and clean. It needs to work for a lot of use cases. So there, list of dependencies is much smaller. So we start with that same list to keep them merging nice and clean. I keep those all bundled together here at the top, just in the same place where they have it, in case they make modifications. So we start with that, and then I begin adding in the things that I want pretty much on any project that I'm going to do. So have you ever had a project where you didn't install admin toolbar? I haven't. Chosen is just a really nice little UI library. I have this horrible, hate relationship with multi-select widgets. They're just the worst UX in the whole world, so I immediately replace all multi-select widgets on Drupal side, front-end and back-end, with the Chosen module, which is maintained by the hardest time-tracking company. And it just makes it really nice for multi-selects.
Do you know if they've made any progress in the accessibility of Chosen?
Oh, I don't. That's a good...
It's kind of been a sticking point for us. I love it, but our accessibility person is always like...
Oh, I didn't know that. I, Didn't really think about it. Thank you for pointing that out.
There's a really long GitHub issue against the Harvest repo that's been going on for like 6 years or something.
Okay, so for the folks at home, Kelly was asking about the accessibility of the chosen widget, and so apparently that's definitely something. Thank you for pointing that out. But I want to, maybe I'll just keep it on the back end because we don't have too much in the way. We actually do have one project right now with I think the National Institute for Blind something, where we do have some editors who need an accessible back end, which is a real challenge. We got pretty good with the front end, but
your back end's
more
problems than just the chosen
one. Yeah. So it's a good thing to keep in mind. The clean maintenance module helps. If you ever do turn on maintenance mode, or you decide to turn on maintenance mode for whatever reason, this just cleans it up a little bit. I just saw it at the last camp I was at. I'm like, oh, that's cool, and I just threw it in there. Probably need to test that a little bit more. This is really important. Config split and config tools. I have a lot of, we'll see in a minute, some of the initial customizations that I set up whenever the site gets installed, that allows me to immediately have different configuration folders for each of my environments. So a local, dev, test, and live. And that's really, really super helpful and something that I need on every single site that that I go on. And sometimes what happens is if we don't have a template like this, then things slip through the cracks, right? Like turning off the devel module in production, right? That's something that needs to happen. I'm not just devel, but in lots of little performance things. You need to customize the environment to be different in production than in dev. Well, if you're crushed up against a deadline, that's easily something that just slips through the cracks or gets pushed to the, oh, we'll do that post-launch or whatever, and then it never ends up happening. So if I can set that stuff up to just work out of the box the way I need to, then, you know, I don't have to worry about it.
How do you export to, like, your production config? Is there just a flag for config export that puts it in your...
Yeah, so the question is about how do we export configs differently for the different environments. That, check out the config split module page, and they kind of give you an overview of how it works. But it uses, I think, like the configuration provider module. There's some, it has some of its own dependencies, and it basically hooks into the import-export process for config management. And I use my settings files, which I'll show you in a minute how I set that up. I use my settings files to determine what environment I'm in, right? So the site knows whether it's live, dest, or whatever. And depending on that environment flag, it will import the correct configs for that environment, and similarly, it will export the correct configs. So if I'm in test and I run a config export, it will export those configs. So that's how we, and you can do it through the UI as well.
And do you commit all those to the repo?
Yep.
All the environment configs.
Yep. So the question was, do we commit those to the repo? And we do. So we've got the separate folders. We commit all those configs to the repo, and what was I going to say? Yeah, so those get version controlled along with the regular config for dev. And so, yeah, so you can go in and select on a module by module basis which ones you want to be in which environment. There's, it gets stupidly like complex if you really get into it. There's like gray lists and white lists and black lists, and I just kind of use mostly the blacklist one, where I definitely don't want this module turned on in production, so I blacklist it and it just runs in dev and stuff like that. And similar, but you know, there's the inverse is true too. So for example, the some performance modules, so like some the Drupal core caching modules and page cache and things like that, I want to make sure those are on in production but off in dev. There's also, I haven't actually used it yet on a production site, but there's this thing called config tools, which allows you to set up an alternate repo that tracks changes, any configuration changes that happen in production, right? So I've got my configuration set up to automatically import whenever a new push happens to with a production or test environments, just automatically imports. which is great, fine, and dandy, but if anyone has gone in there and configured something in production, which they shouldn't, but if they do, that change will get lost. So config tools will actually track the changes as they happen in real time and automatically commit them to a separate Git repo. So you've got a Git history of any changes. So it's easy, very easy before deployment or even after deployment to go back and say, oops, did I wipe out any changes? And then the Git history will show you. So that's very nice. You know, a tweak is something I use on almost every project. It's always useful. Just having these little things available makes my development faster and easier. And I just, you know, I've got all my, it's like having a nice tool shed. You wouldn't want to like, you know, start building a house with all your tools, you know, kind of like spread out willy-nilly. You want to have a nice like shop set up. And it's going to speed up your building process a whole lot to be nice and organized. So that's what this does for us. Okay, so we talked about adding modules, semantic versioning. So another interactive question here. What is semantic versioning? Nope, no looking. Any ideas?
Major, minor, match.
There you go. So it is a convention. It really is nothing other than a convention for how to version our software. So Drupal core, in our case, we have to sort of bastardize it a little bit, because for any module or project that we make, the major version is always the Drupal core version, right? So 8, 7, or 8 is major. And then, so if I have like a 2.1 version of some module that I'm maintaining, the actual semantic version of that would be 8.2.1. However, when I go ahead and include it in my composer.json, you'll notice that there's no 8 here, there's no, you know, so we basically just lose a significant, you know, we lose a digit because of the way that we have to do it. Now, there are some modules that depend on a specific, I think Acquia's Lightning distro, like, depends on specific versions of Drupal 8, right? So they need like 8.1 or something like that. And so I forget exactly what they do, but they have to use an even stranger kind of version convention to get around that. Actually, let's go back over here real quick to the required dev. So what's the difference between require and required dev?
Totally in development.
Ideally, yes, that's the idea. But turns out, if you just run composer install in your production environment, it will install all of these modules. So, you know, for the required dev area of your composer.json is actually more geared towards making sure that it's more for like libraries. So if for projects that depend on another project, on a library or something like that, these are packages that are not needed for this library to run on another site. So in other words, I need these libraries to work on and build my project, but anyone who is depending on my project or using my project don't need these. So it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense in our case, because there's never going to be another project that depends on this project, right? This is like this is sort of the end of the line. I'm not building a library that's going to be used by someone else. So why do I have this here at all? Well, it is possible to specifically exclude dev dependencies. So I put things in here that are excluded also from config split. So we talked about that before, how I can exclude certain modules. So in the live environment, I can run composer install dash dash no dev, and that will make sure that these modules don't even show up. Why do that? Well, I guess it sort of might save a few microseconds or milliseconds on Drupal Bootstrap, because there are fewer files that the autoloader needs to like parse through or something, I don't know. But just keeps it nice and clean. Definitely not a major requirement, but where possible, I try and do that. All right, so we talked about semantic versioning and the changes that we use in the Drupal naming conventions. Let's talk about libraries. So if we go back up and look at this, the last dependency in the list here is called Composer Installers Extender. So we've also got Composer Installers up here. And then we have the extender. So what those two things allow us to do is to come down here into the installer types and installer paths configuration. And this allows us to place certain projects in certain folders. So a good example of this is there was, the other day I needed the jQuery Colorbox library. And the if we look at the Colorbox module on drupal.org, it tells you that the library needs to exist inside of your libraries folder. It doesn't actually need to be inside all, it's just kind of like, well, that's for Drupal 7, but same idea for Drupal 8, where is it? Okay, yeah, libraries. And it needs to be in library slash colorbox slash, and then the actual JavaScript file is being included. Now the problem is that the name of the package is jQuery-colorbox. And so we're downloading, and by default, Composer puts the project in the folder with the same name as the project, right? So I needed a way to have it rename that folder, and I was able to do that. Oh, hello. It's not looking so great. So, just to give you a quick example here, you can see down in my installer paths, you can see I've got this special exception for Colorbox. So I'm telling Composer, hey, I want you to take this project, this library, which is in, under the NPM asset organization or whatever, and normally it would live inside of the jQuery-colorbox folder, but that's not where the Colorbox module is looking for it to include it. It's looking for it inside of just Colorbox. So this is how we get around that. This allows us to place our libraries wherever we need to. It's also how you can specify, it's a little more flexible than that. You can set up general rules, like for any project that is of type component or NPM asset, I want you to put them in this folder, right? So by default, anything, any NPM asset projects or libraries will end up inside of my libraries folder. So for most things, that works just fine. We have a special exception for Colorbox. One note is that this needs to live above, it needs to be before the other naming convention because it just sticks with the first one it matches. And at first I had it down there, and I was really confused why it wasn't working, so because this project matched on both of these rules. So anyways, coming back to this. Okay, so I think that covers, let's talk real quick about minimum stability. So there, you know, obviously there's security considerations and other things, so I can't like say, yes, it's okay to use dev modules, but every once in a while it does happen. So, or alpha or beta or whatever. So I don't like, it's not great when I need to do that, but it is. But it does happen. So by setting the minimum stability to dev, it just makes it easier for me to be able to say, hey, Composer require Drupal slash, you know, foo module, my module. And if only an alpha version is available or only a dev version is available, it will happily just go and get that. However, if there is a stable version available because of this other flag I have set, then it will default to grabbing the most stable one. So for me, this is the most developer-friendly workflow. If you have minimum stability set to something higher or not set at all, I think it defaults to stable, then you have to specifically give a flag. It will say, you know, Composer require Drupal slash my module, and it will say, sorry, I can't do that. It you know, actually, it'll take like 30 seconds and sit there and think about it, and then it'll tell you, sorry, I can't do that. There's no version available that meets your minimum requirements. And you're like, God damn it. I don't care, just give me the beta version. So then you have to add the little at beta flag onto the version constraint. So this is just kind of works, you can set it and forget it. All right, scripts. There's a few scripts that come with the Drupal project repository, like Drupal scaffold, which you need for initially setting up your project. And I always include one called test, which calls npm test, because we're typically using Node to compile front-end dependencies and compile SAS and JavaScript and all that good stuff. And then also run code sniffer. So this will run the Drupal coding standards on all code inside of the custom modules directory, custom themes directory, and then this other little util file that we'll look at in just a minute as well. Let's see here. One other thing I'll mention real quick about the Drupal project is that there's two different ways to get started with it. You, by default, it will ask you, the default way to do it is to commit some of the core scaffolding files like index.html or index.php. Let's look at getting more actually see. So by default, if you're not using my little fork here, all of these files right here will get committed to your repo. Now, what I mentioned earlier was that I hate having code committed to my other repo that isn't mine or someone on my team. So I want to keep things nice and clean. So what I do is I just have Drupal scaffold run. I set it up with a little flag, and it will, if these files are not present, it will download them to your local, but it will never commit them to the repository. So these are called scaffolding files, and they're kind of like the scaffold for Drupal core, I guess. Best way to put it. See, I've got other config files in here, like for Lando, so it becomes very easy to spin up a Lando site. And every time I finish a project, this is always a work in progress. Every time I finish a project, I take the things that we did in that I liked, and I port it back into this project. So, for example, right now with that other one that you saw that I showed just a minute ago with the color box, there's been several changes in there that I want to backport into this project. We just recently upgraded one of our projects from CircleCI's API version 1 to CircleCI API version 2. And so I asked that developer to make a pull request against this repo and backport those changes, and that was the last pull request that was accepted. So it's always a work in progress. This is more relevant information. So we looked briefly at the npm asset and packages, and what that. So when you add, come back to this. So we looked at repositories before, we skipped over this, but by adding this repository to your composer.json, it gives you access to the entire list of packages in the npm registry and the Bower registry. So we can pull any of those in and use them on our projects, like jQuery Colorbox or whatever other kind of JavaScript package that we want. A lot of times those either don't exist in the like official PHP packages registry, or they don't exist in the right version, like maybe they're out of date or whatever, they're not actively maintained. So rather than having to maintain those packages in two places, in a PHP registry and an NPM registry, we can just pull them in straight from the NPM registry. So it's really quite nice. But it does require a little bit of extra setup to get that working. All right, so now we'll jump into some more of the fun, sexy things for about 10 or 15 minutes, and hopefully leave a little bit of time for some questions. So Let's look at some of the other ways you can customize your start state. So this has been all about the whoops.json. There's a lot you can do to get things rock and rolling for yourself. But there are other things you can do as well. We've already looked at a couple of them, setting up my Circle CI settings. Now a lot of this stuff will require customization once I actually start a new project, right? So I'll need to go into the Lando file and it says in big all caps change me. So we don't want all of our Lando projects named drupal-project, so I'm thinking about making a list of everything you need to change in this repo to customize it for a new project. But so anything that you use on a regular basis, if you use grunts for your build tasks, if you, we used to run Drupal VM, so we have the Vagrant file here. There's some patches that we always want to commit to Drupal core, and then there's one for Drupal chosen as well. And we run a lot of our sites on Pantheon. If we're not running on Pantheon, then we'll just delete this YAML file after getting started.
How do you have your patches on a separate file? Does that just work? So is it the naming convention?
It doesn't. It is right down here.
Oh, sweet.
Yep. I'd kind of rather just keep on the same file, but we had it set up that way at one time, and it just kind of stuck. So
yeah.
We talked a little bit about code sniffing standards. There's also linting standards and things like that. So this is all stuff that is kind of just boilerplate configuration you can include in there if you want. Well, let's look at more Drupal specific stuff. So let us look at our settings files. So here's that utility class I mentioned earlier. There's oftentimes in a lot of our projects we've needed things to support redirects inside of our settings files, enforcing SSL, redirecting wildcards, all things that for whatever one reason or another need to happen sort of outside the scope of a Drupal module and inside of the settings files. So, I just got tired of copy-pasting them between projects, and so I just put them in there. And might should maybe be a project of its own repo, but for now it's just right there. Now let's look at our settings.php. So this is committed to the repository, and this never ever has to change. That's the beautiful thing about the settings file, that because in this directory, inside of any subdirectory of web/sites, Drupal will automatically configure permissions on it to be non-writable, which means that if I'm collaborating with someone else, or if I make some changes in here and I commit those changes to settings.php and I push them up to the repo, when someone else goes to pull in those changes, they're going to get a big flag warning from Git saying, and it's a very confusing error. Git will say, cannot unlink file sites default settings.php. What the hell, unlink? All unlink means is delete. You can't delete the file because Drupal has set permissions on this directory to be read-only for good reasons. So, but it's a pain in the neck. So I've set up our settings.php to simply include the other files that we need, which live outside of this directory. So all the main settings that we want actually live inside of the sites directory, not inside of sites default. So you can see it's doing three things here. First, it's including settings.common, which is settings across all of our environments. It's including an environment-specific settings file, settings.dev, settings.test, settings.live. And you'll see that this environment, this variable right here gets defined inside of common settings, which we'll look at in just a minute. And then finally, if a settings.local file does exist, it will use that.
Can you explain the anonymous function?
Yes, thank you for asking. So, one because I'm anal retentive and I like things to be super, super clean, I hate, there's some logic, some PHP code in some of these files where I'm defining, I'm creating a new variable, right? Let's say I need to, we'll look at it in a minute, but in a few different places I need to define a variable. That happens at the global scope. So if I create a variable called, something, like file name or something like that, suddenly that variable is available at the global scope. And it doesn't need to be. And it just kind of has always irked me and bugged me. And so by wrapping this in an anonymous function, any variables that get defined in here can get destroyed, garbage collected as soon as the sentence file inclusion wraps up. And these are the only variables that will, you know, the ones that I'm specifically passing in by reference are the only ones that will carry on after this finishes, because they already exist outside the scope of the anonymous function.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay, so looking back at the sites directory, let's look at settings.common. So you'll see the first thing we have to do is define, well, actually the very first thing we do is include any environment specific settings. So we often host with platform SH, so, or Pantheon, so first thing we need to do is include those settings from the hosting provider. And then we need to figure out which environment we're in. And this, again, depends on hosting. So for platform, this is how we figure out what, we use this environment variable right here called platform branch. In Pantheon, there's a global constant that gets defined called Pantheon environment. So one way or another, based on whatever logic you set up, you figure out what environment you're in. And then we proceed with things that apply to all of our environments. Setting the Drupal hash salt, stuff like that. Now we can look at, start with the simplest ones first. So live is pretty simple. I've got some boilerplate code in there that if you so choose, you can enforce HTTPS. That's typically better done at your hosting provider level, but you can do that. Here. Actually, no. This is where we enforce HTTPS. Up here is where you can redirect from. You know, if you have your production environment being served at two different domains, for example, mysite-live.pantheonsite.io, also mysite.com. You can force anyone who goes to the Pantheon version of that of the site to get redirected to the main URL. We turn off stage file proxy. This is, Andy, this is where the config split gets turned on. So this is how you know you're in the live environment. That's how config split knows you're in the live environment. Test is very similar. Let's look at dev. So in dev, there's a lot more going on in here because there's a lot of things I want to happen in my dev environment. I want to use a special services.yaml file to turn on twig debugging and do things like that. I want to turn on verbose error logging. I want to turn off a bunch of performance processing. I want to turn off certain cache bins. And just other things that make it less secure but easier to debug. And less performant but easier to debug. So this is an important one. If you're using Kint on your site, it will often just make your page crash. Kint is like the Drupal 8 version of Crumo, if you remember from the devel module, that just basically pretty prints out your debug data. And it will crash your page if it just infinitely nests through the data that it's printing out. So you gotta cut it off at some point. And my, you know, 5 seems to be a kind of good in-between area. It can still take a while to load, but it's usually not too bad. And then this is just some default database configuration that works for Lando, because most of our guys are using Lando, myself included. And so, you know, if it hasn't been defined somewhere else already, then we go ahead and set the database settings up here. These can also be defined inside of settings.local.php. In the case of the actual dev environment, my hosting provider, this will have been defined inside of their settings file that I included earlier. So that's why I'm checking to see if it's already defined or not. All right. Lastly, I want to look real quickly at this little custom module that I include by default. So the name of the module is in our composer.json, and it's called kala-config. So you'll see it here, including a dependency on kala-config. So if we go to that project, you'll see this is just a custom module that does a few things for us, mostly inside of the install. Well, so when it gets installed, it just sets up the site really nice for me. I typically install my sites with a standard installation profile. Sometimes I'll use Lightning or something like that, but typically it's default. But there are a few things I don't really like with it. I never need the article content type. I like the page, but I don't need article. I don't need shortcuts so I don't need the shortcut module. So I install some of those things. Now you might ask, why not just install with a minimal profile? Well, I could, but there are some things I actually do like getting from standard, and any other modifications or improvements they make in the future, I want to get those too. So I start with standard and then subtract. And then I set up a few other configuration settings, like for chosen, and develop toolbar, and config tools. So these are just a few things that I want configured in my environment as soon as it spins up. Right, so when I install the site, I turn on this module, it sets everything up, and then it does something really cool. You can see I'm registering a shutdown function here, which means after everything else is finished, PHP will, the request has been sent back to the browser or to your terminal, whatever, and then it will start begin executing these shutdown functions. So what I do from here is I actually uninstall myself, right? So I turn off this Kali config module, its work is done. We don't need it running. And we don't need it running anymore. It doesn't do anything actively. It's just merely for setup. So I uninstall myself. I figure out what the paths for each config split, and then I go ahead and issue an export for each of those. So I am getting it as soon as I install my site and turn on this module. I'm immediately setting up all the configuration the way I like it, and then exporting it into my config files. So all I have to do from that point is run git add, git commit, git push, and boom, I've got a new site with all my configurations set up just the way I like, and anyone else can go grab that configuration and run a configuration install with that configuration. It's one thing we didn't talk about, but you can actually install a site from an existing set of configuration. So early on in projects, before we had a database with useful content in it, a lot of times we don't even bother with database dumps, we just install the site from configuration. So, let's see if I can do a little live demo here and see if it'll actually work. So, let's see here. Okay, so this, I don't think I've got the latest code on here. Port 22 is blocked and I don't feel like setting up to the other URL, so we're just gonna roll with whatever old version I have of my Drupal project fork here, and I'm just going to run, first of all, lando start. See, I've got a lando file here set up, Drupal project, so make sure it's turned on. So there we go, boom shakalaka, it is running. So now I'm going to run lando drush si for site install and lando drush enable dash y kali config, and let's just start with that. And we should, do we want to drop all the tables? Yeah, I'm sure whatever else testing wasn't that important, so. For the purpose of the demo, I probably should have run composer install, but I just assume you've already seen that process happen. Now look at this giant list of modules that's getting turned on. This is turning on, it's not using composer.json for this, it's actually using Kali config. So if we look at the info file for that project, you'll see that I have a whole bunch of dependencies in there. This is basically everything that I want, all the modules that I want turned on my site right off the bat. So I use it as like a kind of like an installation profile. But because we don't yet have the ability to extend installation profiles like we can with themes, we can't have like a base profile, this just gets around that limitation. So alright, so I have a fresh install, I've enabled Kali config, and now let me run a ULI with this. And voila, let's see what happens. Look at that. Ta-da. So I've got a fresh site, and I've got my toolbar turned on. I've got the develop module turned on. I've got these was some settings that I configured to the develop toolbar. And I've got access to all of the development tools that I like having. You can see the article content type is gone. We have, let me see what else. We can look at the extend page and just look at all the modules that are turned on. And you know, this just configures everything right off the bat the way I like it. You can see the chosen module, boom, is there. Show that working. So let's add a field. Now find a multi-select. Where is a good place to find a multi-select? I thought there was one on this page. Anyways, we are at time over time, so I'm gonna leave it there. But any questions? And if you have any later on, feel free to find me or hit me up on the GitHubs or the Drupals or and it's hard to find me anywhere else, really. Not really on Twitter. Well, I guess you can email me. That's cool. Or Drupal Slack. All right. Thanks, guys.